The legendary celebrated Vyšehrad, the site of the origins of our statehood. It was a favorite location of several distinguished personages, such as Karol Hynek Máka, Josef Mánes, Josef Václav Myslbek, Mikuláš Aleš, and Bedřich Smetana, and today a popular haunt of Pragers. We too shall set out on a tour of Prague in the company of people who truly are well acquainted not only with Vyšehrad, but with the whole city. Come.
Vyšehrad is one of the most important sites in our history. Vratislav II, the first Czech king, used it as his residence after his coronation. The fabulous residence of Princess Libuša also flourished under Charles IV. But after being burnt down by the Hussites, the significance of Vyšehrad declined, and in the end it was changed into a military fortification. The only fully preserved site from pre-Hussite Vyšehrad is the Romanesque Rotunda of St. Martin, which later also served as a military storage facility for gunpowder. The Capitulatory Church of Saints Peter and Paul was formerly Romanesque, then Gothic, with modification in the Renaissance period, substantial modifications in a Baroque style. It obtained its final neo-Gothic appearance at the beginning of the last century. The most valuable of its internal furnishings are the Romanesque sarcophagus and the Gothic painting of Lowly Madonna.
When one has the opportunity to travel further and see the world, one realizes what a great gift it was to be born in Prague and live one's life in Prague. Without doubt, it is the most beautiful city in Europe. Long ago, as a student, I used to tell myself that perhaps Florence could compete, but I believe that all who can live and work in Prague may appreciate the luck they have. It is an exceptional city. Always, when I hear the word Vyšehrad, I see the Vyšehrad cliff, the river, and all the mystery which shrouds the cradle of our culture.
Vyšehrad has undergone comprehensive archaeological digs, which uncovered Roman masonry and paving stones from the Basilica of St. Vavřinec. Work on reconstruction of the fortification has recently been intensified.
I'm not an advocate of an explicitly rigorous monument conservation policy. Naturally, it's very important that conservationists are very strict on us as investors. We are well aware that we operate on the territory of the National Cultural Monument of Vyšehrad. It is truly land on which we must tread carefully. Each adjustment to Vyšehrad is a return to certain condition. It's not an invention of completely new things. This means that here it concerns which part of the monumental period a person wishes to concentrate on. Within this, there is the possibility of free creativity. This means that there certainly exists here space for the modern era, modern technology and the use thereof. However, this must be treated very sensitively and must be used always in such a manner as to assist the monument and not to make the modern element itself visible and emphasized. Its role must be always to assist.
The mighty Baroque citadel in a pentagon shape is a good place for jousting like knights in 2004. The atmosphere of the locality is also supplemented by the sculptures of Josef Myslbek, the provost's residence, and a copy of the statue of the patron saint of the Czechs, Saint Václav, which at one time stood in the center of town. Vyšehrad is the first site along the course of the river Vltava that is charted on the map as a Prague Heritage Reserve. The reserve was recorded in 1992 as the largest urban reserve on the UNESCO International Cultural and Natural Heritage List. Vyšehrad inspired a number of the most prominent artists, and for some of them it became their final resting place.
And whoever has even once traversed that long and mournful path from the living and the dead there to Vyšehrad, up to that peak now crammed in the gloom of light, its banks lit up with a fiery red glow of funeral processions, shall never again forget this impression. The thorny path, the Czech herd, the mound of the Passion, and at the top Žalov, the realm of the dead. Looking over that great animated city of Prague, the threadbare rushing Vltava, fanned by the dewy wings of westerly breezes. In his journal from 1881, Jan Neruda entitled this Slavín Žalovem, and 10 years later, he himself was buried right here in these grounds. The elite of the Czech nation is buried here. However, Karel Hynek Mácha, for example, had to wait longer for his funeral at Slavín. His remains were brought here in 1939, which was certainly no romantic period for Prague, but nevertheless, this too is part of Slavín's history.
Under Charles IV, the coronation route for Czech kings went through Vyšehrad, ending here at Prague Castle. These days, millions of Czech and foreign tourists pour through the place.
Few can resist this view, the rivers of Malostrana, the Lesser Quarter, one of the most beautiful views Prague has to offer. But I would say not only Prague, but the whole of Europe, and why not the whole world? Opposite is the majestic silhouette of Prague Castle. History has been made also on this path. And above the castle flew either the sprightly standards of our rulers or those mysterious darker emblems of occupiers. Thankfully, that is in the past. And today, the president is at home.
Pan prezident je doma.
Tomáš Garrigue Masaryk made Prague Castle, the residence of Czech kings, accessible to the public and set about renovating it. Prague Castle is a stately set of buildings, churches and fortifications, built around three courtyards. From its beginning it was the castle of residence for the Přemysl dynasty. The most recent archaeological digs prove that in 1880, Prince Borzivoj had founded a princely citadel here. Vladislavsky Hall, which the great-grandson of Charles IV, Vladislav Jagiellonski, had constructed, is a rare example of combined Gothic and Renaissance structures. For over 500 years, it has amazed people with its grandeur. The elections for President of the Czech Republic take place here too. The work of restorers on Prague Castle is internationally renowned. They also look after the Czech crown jewels, stored in the crown chamber above the chapel of St. Wenceslas in St. Vitus's Cathedral.
The gradual opening of Prague Castle brings me great joy, because I remember it still as an impenetrable fortress, where it was extremely difficult to come to study any of the castle's treasures, and one had to obtain 1,000 permits and passes in order to get in here at all. And in this it is particularly important for me, because with this opening of the castle, making accessible to the public its collections, we are displaying what people do not know, that the castle is not only a huge imposing building, a great architectural complex, but also a place of first-rate collections, very often unparalleled in the Czech Republic, and one of the oldest collections, such as the St. Vitus's treasure and the Prague Castle Gallery. And it is our duty to present these collections. We have attempted to do this with the story of Prague Castle as a kind of first national exhibition, which is to open, let us say, a sequence of further additional exhibitions to present Czech history in its most significant periods. And let us be honest, also to preserve our nationhood. I believe that the castle has one special element, that in fact, since the 10th century, it has been a town within a town. It has its own special atmosphere with regard to the larger town, and here fulfills all the functions of a normal medieval town. This history today follows us at every step, and when one walks through the castle, it is as if one is passing through a kind of compendium of architecture, a compendium of historical styles. So, it is a kind of integral component of this town precisely because of its own, let us say, small town character.
Prague Castle was the residence of Czech kings, and from 1918 it has been residence of presidents of Czechoslovakia and now of the Czech Republic. Receptions for notable international delegations also take place here. On famous Czech historical anniversaries, the castle spaces are open to the public. In this way, people can take pleasure in viewing the beauty and elegance of the castle halls. The dominant structure of Prague Castle is St. Vitus's Cathedral. Visitors to the city always come here. The former sanctuary was built by Prince Václav I as a round pre-Roman structure with four bell ends. And into one of them were stored the remains of Prince Václav, murdered at the site of an ancient settlement in Stara Boleslav by his brother Boleslav. The foundation stone of the new church was laid by Emperor Charles IV on November 21st, 1344. Several rulers tried to complete it, but its ceremonial consecration took place in 1929, on St. Wenceslas's millennium. The structure, with a typical cathedral ground plan, was inspired by the architecture of southern France. Large personalities from history quite long ago took part in the construction and decoration of the church, such as Peter and Paul Parler and Matthias Braun. It was also worked on by representatives of a period not long ago, such as Josef Václav Misselbeck, František Bílek and Ottokar Spaniel. People like Max Schwabinski, Alfons Mucha and Karel Svolinski took part in window plating. However, Prague Castle isn't only St. Vitus's Cathedral and the Royal Palace. It's also the Basilica of St. George, with the former Benedictine cloister, Lobkowitzky Palace, the Chapel of the Holy Cross, and Golden Lane.
This house was purchased by my grandfather at the end of the 19th century. My mother was born here, followed by my sister, and later myself. At that time, everything looked different here. A family lived in each house, mostly very poor people. There were two variety stores here. Mrs. Uzlova lived in this house, and here, as we go down the steps, here on the right, lived one man. I think his name was Mikulka. So we did not have to go far for ordinary items. There was a pub over there, I used to go there to get beer for my father. Life then was completely different. Tourists have always come here, but nowadays as many tourists pass through here each day as came by in a year back then. Prague Castle in its present form and function naturally cannot be a residential complex, despite the fact that a number of flats exist here, which we have inherited. But we wish for Prague Castle to be a place which serves visitors, which serves Praguers as well as tourists from all over the world, of whom over 5 million pass through each year. What we call the project of the Prague Castle Revival means that we wish to make these premises, which lie on the main tourist routes, as accessible as possible to the public, so that Prague Castle can fulfill these demands of a first-rate cultural institution, which it indisputably is.
When looking at the distinctive buildings of Prague Castle, we must not forget the Riding Hall, Gallery and Black Tower.
The concept of Prague is so strong that I believe it can succeed in overcoming even that deeply rooted local patriotism in the Czech Republic. Prague is a symbol of Czech statehood. It is an example of Czech culture, but also an example of the skill of the Czech people. I have in mind all Moravians as well as Bohemians. Prague is in fact a gauge of all that takes place within the Czech Republic, and we all compare ourselves with Prague. But not only us, the whole world is beginning to compare itself with Prague.
The castle surrounds a number of beautiful gardens, which were made back in the Renaissance period. At that time, the royal gardens originated with the renowned Ball Game Hall. The Royal Summer House, also called Belvedere, is one of the most beautiful and most structurally pure Renaissance buildings north of the Alps.
A while ago, we showed you a panorama of the roofs of Malostrana from Prague Castle. And now, something else entirely. These are the Hradčany Gardens. Can you see the contrast? And all within a relatively small area. Further evidence that this has been the home of generations of architects, artists and developers, as well as rulers and governors over the centuries. And it is all the more valuable that this harmonious and balanced whole has resulted.
Emperor Rudolf II also took part in reconstructing the castle gardens. Francesco Terzia also contributed with his work. He designed the singing fountain, as did Antonin Brown with Allegory of the Night, and also the renowned modern castle architect Josip Plečník. We look at Prague from the beginning of the third millennium, at a time of computers and globalization. We say goodbye with a view of the city, a view that has for centuries remained inscribed in the hearts of both residents and visitors to this astounding city.